to headlines filled with devastation again. My heart is broken, but I keep going. Pain, but I won't let it turn into hate. No, I won't let it change me. Never lose inside of the one I keep inside. Now I know it, yeah, I know it. You can't take my guilt away. Soul of mine will never pay. As long as I wake up today, you can't take my youth away. You can't take my guilt away. The soul of mine will never pay. As long as I wake up today, you can't take my youth away. You can't take my youth away. It's hard to sleep at night, knowing what's outside. Feeling hopeless, I need focus. You hit me with words I never heard come out your mouth. To be honest, I don't want it, no. Pain, but I won't let it turn into hate. No, I won't let it change me. You can't take my youth away. Soul of mine will never pay. As long as I wake up today, can't take my youth away. You can't take my youth away. The soul of mine will never break. As long as I wake up today, you can't take my youth away. You can't take my youth away. You can't take my youth away.
Pain, but I won't let it turn into hate. No, I won't let it change me.
Let me just check the bios, just sort out the bios. Oh.
Yeah.
The first one is Gabriel.
Yeah.
Gabriel is the first one that's very important. Let's start with that. I just want to cut it out and put it here. Gabriel, already we had something from online stuff about you.
Sorry?
We had your information.
Yeah, okay. More information.
This one about he's the author,
yeah,
and editor of numerous books, etc.
Yeah,
et
yeah.
That's all good. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
Excellent. Right.
I am the architect
in Argentina.
Yeah. This is in the United States. There is my national imagination. And my last book, is Controversial Inequality, and my last book is Death That Matter.
Oh, this is the last book?
This is my book.
Okay, Controversies.
This is my last
book. We have your books here, actually. We have your information. Here it is.
Okay. It's okay.
Yes.
Okay, should I?
Just a minute. I just want to reconcile this information.
Okay, welcome everybody to this session, this plenary, sub-plenary session on racism, xenophobia, and violence. I'm John Holmwood, and this is Simon MAPADIMENG, who will be, we are the co-organizers of the session, but Simon will be chairing the session. Before we begin with an introduction of the speakers, what I want to do is restate what was set out in detail in the opening ceremony, that we all would like to acknowledge that the land on which we gather is the traditional territory of the indigenous peoples of this region. Welcome, Simon.
Thank you, John, as a co-chair. We welcome you to this special plenary, the plenary on violence and xenophobia. We have an esteemed panel here of speakers, and we're going to be introducing each as they come to the podium. We're going to be starting with, first with Gabriel. Just a minute, I just want to sort out something. Professor Gabriel KESSLER, who is the professor at La Plata University and a senior researcher at National Research Council in Argentina. His fields of interest are violence, inequality, public policy in Latin America. He wrote a number of books, amongst which, just a minute, I think I don't want to mix up your profile here. Yes, Professor Gabriel KESSLER has written a number of books, including, amongst others, The New Poverty in Argentina, with Planeta, which was published in 1995. He wrote yet another book, Sociology of Amateur Crime, published in 2004. And another book is Neoliberalism and National Imagination, published with Routledge 2005, co-written with A. Grimson. And also another book that he wrote is The Fragmented School Experience, published in 2002. The Feeling of Insecurity, published in 2009. Individualism, Individuation, Precariousness and Risk, with R. Castell and Mecken and Pidos, 2012, and of course, another book also, Controversies on Inequality, and finally, the book that is much more recent, yeah, the one about controversies about inequality and death that matter. Fellow sociologists, fellow colleagues, friends, I call upon on the stage Professor KESSLER.
My PowerPoint. Yeah. This presentation. You have my PowerPoint, please.
Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you. Good afternoon. I'm very pleased to be here. Violence, inequality, and discrimination have been part of Latin America since the beginning of its colonial history. Centuries of violence and discriminations against indigenous, Afro-Latino populations, women, the LGBT community, and the poor. Violence in the form of state terrorism during the military dictatorships of the 20th century, and human rights violations today, and the epidemic of urban violence in the past decades. We are also immersed in persistent social, political, ethnic, and gender inequality. The situation today is complex and contradictory. It presents similarities, but also differences between countries, continuities and breaks with the past. For example, in relation to violence, the homicide rate varies up 20 times between countries, but robberies and fear of crime are rampant across Latin America. We are still the world's most unequal region, but that inequality has diminished in the most of Latin American countries over the past decade. The poor have improved their lot, but the rich have also grown even richer. Crime grew in proportion to the rise in inequality during the neoliberal reforms in the 1990s, but it continued to grow even when inequality dropped. Indigenous people, Afro-Latin Americans, LGBT groups, and women are more empowered and mobilized than they were in the past. But there has also been a strong and preoccupying backlash against these movements. This current scenario of overlapping trends poses new questions for Latin American sociology. The question that I would like to answer is how sociology has examined this problem and the connection. My argument is, until recently, we have found it difficult to analyze the connection and the relationship between inequality, violence, exclusion, and discrimination. Maybe with some exception like Brazilian sociology. Why? Because of historical reasons, the limitations of our theoretical and colonial paradigms, and because of the way of sociology was constructed. I am going to show how this is changing. But to understand the present, we need to look back at a certain moment in the past. Okay. How did sociology approach this topic in the 1950s and 1960s as the field was taking shape? This sociology was created within national narratives that celebrated ethnically diverse identities, but always within the context of a melting pot that merged this different identity into a single type of citizen, rendering minorities almost invisible. Discrimination, in general, discrimination, was seen like a remnant from the past and was outside the scope of academic reflection. For example, functionalism was optimistic about modernization and about the social mobility that was taking place, which were also expected to put an end to discrimination. In general, violence was not the topic addressed by sociology at the beginning. But this changed with the military dictatorship of the 1970s. During the transition to democracy in the 1980s, there was a big concern about political violence and state violence. Dictatorships had killed and disappeared those who they considered enemies of a state. Any political militant or social leader was considered as a dangerous other. Sociology began to make connection with violence from the past and with historical discrimination. For example, most of the victims of Central America were members of indigenous group and rural population. But looking it back, I believe that we have yet to fully understand the importance of color and ethnicity in political repression in many other countries, like in my country, Argentina, or for example, in Chile. Neoliberal reforms in almost all the countries in the region in the 1990s exacerbated exclusion. At the same time, crime and violence increased across Latin America. This first occurred in the countries where drug trafficking was most rampant, like in Brazil, but in particular in Colombia, where was a strong and long-term relationship with political violence. In the mid-1990s, juvenile crime had grown in the rest of the region, This is when sociology began to carry out in-depth studies on violence. One common explanation was exclusion, but less in terms of race are more in terms of class and age. Exclusion from schools and especially from the labor market, which was shrinking under neoliberal reform, were two of the focuses. Maybe no unique theories were produced, but we did make some interesting contribution regarding exclusion. I'll cite just a few here. Studies in Colombia on the sicariato, young marginals hired as hitmen by drug trafficking organizations, illustrated an ideal of a short but intense life that contrasted with the longer but poorer and more humdrum lives of parents. Brazilian sociology explained how drug dealing gained a foothold in marginal neighborhoods by satisfying demands that the state had never been able to meet, such as social services. In my own work in Argentina, I showed the blurred borders between work, school, and crime, and the possibility of movement between them over time. This challenged the notion of a criminal career as an increasing involvement over time. One common pattern was that our studies depicted how neoliberalism enhanced a strong individualism which eroded community bonds in the poor populations. Was the topic of discrimination present in this work? It received more attention than it had in the past, in particular in Brazil, where skin color was a critical element to violence. Even though we made links with stigmatization, not enough attention was paid to long-term and embedded discrimination. In the 2000s, the situation has changed both in academia and in Latin America at large. Politics in the region were swept by a pink tide. 10 out of 14 Latin American countries had leftist or center-left administration between 2003 and 2010. Notable exceptions were Mexico and Colombia. Inequality was at the forefront of academic and political discourse once again. There was a greater presence of social movements with the power of interpolation. In a similar process, academia very gradually became less white, more female, and with the greater presence of other classes previously excluded from scholarship. Have we finally managed to acknowledge the connection between inequality, violence, exclusion, and discrimination in our work? Were we able to establish the ties between past and present? I would say that today is still, it's a work in progress. How is the connection being forged? Less in a general perspective and more in specific fields and topics through new questions and diverse social interpolation. For example, in my own work, I have to answer a question that I have not answered yet. Why wasn't the drop in inequality followed by a reduction of crime? We were used to focusing on hikes in crime and its relation to inequality. We began to work about the relationship between economic growth and crime. Second, professional sociology and public sociology are highly enmeshed in Latin America. Academia has contributed to turn racist state violence into an issue for society. For example, denouncing the number of Afro-Brazilians in Brazilian prisons. There has also been a strong empowerment of indigenous people. However, indigenous groups have challenged our conception of inequality focused on economic distribution and our trust in development. They argue that this reinforces violence against Aboriginal groups through the appropriation of their lands while also violating the rights of the earth and of nature. But without doubt, the feminist movement is currently experiencing a big moment in many countries. Thanks to an interclass, intergenerational coalition within academia and beyond, many countries in the region have decried femicide. Latin American feminist scholars, in particular Mexican feminist scholars, showed the connection between inequality, exclusion, and the state's responsibility in its most terrifying dimension. In this context of change, I want to address one of the questions of the panel. Who is the dangerous other today? This other has no single face and varies according to country, class, gender, and age group. But there is one dangerous other common to all our countries. That dangerous other who is seen as a potential criminal. Is he or she a racialized other? In general, until now, for Latin American sociology, it's more a question of class. But in Latin America, class and ethnicity are strongly associated. Sometimes he or she is a migrant, but in particular, a poor migrant from a neighboring country. Yet that enemy often looks a lot like everyone else. For example, medium-sized cities in Latin America, there is a growing fear of crime, and the dangerous other are those who come from other cities from the same country. But the dangerous other also has a voice to speak out against stigmatization. More and more actors now have a voice, and Latin American sociology adds its voice to these voices, often serving as a sounding board. Finally, I would like to end by sharing what I consider one of the main challenges we face today. In relation to the dangerous other, there is a contradiction that could threaten the future of democracy in the region. The pink tide ended. We are in a different period with different political trends, left, center-left, right, and some extreme-right. But I think that in general, with some exception like Brazil, despite recent backlashes, we are moving toward more liberal democracies, democracies more aware of gender and diversity issues. But they are also democracies that are tougher on crime, with more police violence, severe sentences, and a very high rise in incarceration. Today, that dangerous other can be totally dehumanized, and his or her life is worthless in many people's opinion, according to surveys. We still need to build our own theories connecting the current penal populism with our long-standing history of inequality, violence, and discrimination, in particular with colonial violence and the state terrorism from the past. Latin American sociology must continue working to understand it. For me, this is one of our main challenges as a scholar, but as an activist as well. Thank you.
15, perfect. Uh,
Thank you, Professor Kessler. Next is Professor Michael NEOCOSMOS from South Africa. Professor Michael NEOCOSMOS is the Emeritus Professor in Humanities at Rhodes University in South Africa. He is a distinguished visiting scholar at the University of Connecticut Humanities Institute, United States. He joined WISA, which is a center for social and economic research at the University of Witwatersrand in South Africa as a senior research fellow, associate. He is the author of the book titled From Foreign Natives to Native Foreigners, Rethinking Xenophobia in Post-Apartheid South Africa, published in 2010. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Professor Michael NEOCOSMOS. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I hope I can put this here because I don't have a PowerPoint. So all these things will have to be moved a little bit. I'd like to thank John and Simon for having invited me. You can hear? It's an honor to be here. I just want to make a small number of points, principally concerning resistance to xenophobic violence in South Africa. Resistance by ordinary people, often in informal settlements. I'll tell you a little bit about it as I go along. It seems to me that this is crucially important because through talking a little bit about and understanding resistance to xenophobia among people, we can notice two things. First of all, that xenophobia is not without resistance. It's not because all we hear, both in the literature and in the media, is that xenophobic violence is so prevalent. It is prevalent, but people are resisting. Secondly, I think it enables us to understand popular subjectivities, popular political subjectivities. And as I will argue, it enables us to understand, I think, what is developing sometimes among the poor is a different conception of human universality. So what I'm going to say is going to be divided into three sections. First of all, I'm going to talk about xenophobia and violence as a state-induced political practice. Then I'm going to mention and talk about xenophobic violence as a product of perceived national entitlements in the case of South Africa. And finally, I'm going to outline very briefly three examples of resistance against xenophobia. I start from the assertion, which I've shown in detail in one of my books, that xenophobia must be understood primarily as a state-induced politics, i.e. as a political subjectivity in practice structured by state thinking. Notions such as indigeneity, autochthony, national entitlements, exclusion, etc., all operate within state subjectivities. Cultural or psychological characteristics, attitudes, and so on, are consequences for me or creations of the deployment of such political practices and not their source. So we can start by saying that while the apartheid state in South Africa fostered belonging in terms of race and ethnicity, the post-apartheid state has attempted to foster belonging in terms of nation, but understood in terms of indigeneity. This indigenous conception of the nation was not central to the nationalist popular movements of the 1980s, which understood the centrality of migrant labor from throughout Southern African region in the formation of the South African nation. Rather, the nation was understood in the 1980s by them as composed of all those who supported through their actions and struggle for freedom. And this was far from being everyone. So in other words, in the 1980s, during the popular struggles against the apartheid regime, the idea of the nation was not one which was founded on indigeneity. Okay? For those of you who have read some Frantz Fanon, the idea of national consciousness, which he talks about, was very much prevalent at the time. In other words, the idea of the nation was one which comprised those who were engaged in political action. Now, from the early 1980s, utterances by politicians, the legislation, law enforcement, government departments, and the media all focused on the indigeneity, on discourses of exclusion, on a politics of fear of the other, and on South African exceptionalism vis-a-vis the rest of the African continent in particular. The idea of South African exceptionalism was thus not restricted to whites, but existed in all sectors of the population. So much so that, in fact, surveys have discovered that, in fact, it is impossible to discover a xenophobic profile in the South African population. It's actually impossible to do. Everyone, to a greater or lesser extent, shows characteristics of xenophobic attitudes. So the idea of exclusion and fortress South Africa became prevalent. Politicians blamed those perceived to be foreign migrants for violence, drug dealing, theft, and the prevalence of HIV/AIDS, among others. And migrancy was connected to illegality. Migrants were now seen as coming to take, steal our jobs, our democracy, our health benefits, our houses, our women, etc., and not as coming to provide labor, as they had been perceived before. Now, under such conditions, migrants were identified as leeches on the nation and harassed both formally and informally. And this transition, again, is similar to what Fanon talks about in Wretched of the Earth. Those of you who have read that book recently, which I think is very important in any study of xenophobia. Now, let me look at this, to move towards talking a little bit about xenophobic violence as a product of perceived national entitlements. Now, the post-apartheid state achieved or eschewed any conception of the public good, and through neoliberal conceptions has emphasized the formation of a native bourgeoisie, private accumulation, and corruption among state and state actors, predominantly justified through an emphasis on national belonging, and justified initially at least by a discourse of rights, in particular state discourses emphasizing the right to own resources, especially property, which had previously been denied to middle-class black South Africans. Poorer sectors of the population, while excluded from property ownership, also had access to social benefits by virtue of their nationality or belonging. As a result, the idea of national belonging gradually shifted from an emphasis on rights to one on entitlements, as in conditions of economic exclusion and national fervor, national belonging was seen as an avenue to the acquisition of resources such as jobs, housing, medical care, education, and so on. Now, while for the South African middle class, it was African foreigners in particular who were often seen, African foreign experts, sorry, who were often seen as obstacles to jobs, promotions, and careers, for the poor, it was African formal or informal workers, informal traders, small businesses, and residents who were seen as obstacles to the realization of entitlements apparently due by the state to people freed from apartheid oppression. So foreigners came to be seen as obstacles to state provisioning, if you like. A quick quote, which I think you might find interesting, quote, "We are the ones who fought for freedom and democracy, and now these Somalis are here eating our democracy," end of quote. That statement was made by the National African Federated Chamber of Commerce and Industry leader in Cape Town. Now, as foreign status was determined by prejudice, many rural migrants from South Africa itself also became victims. It's also apparent to note that very few perpetrators of xenophobic violence have been found guilty or subjected to prison terms as a result of such violence. as I okay. And no one has was published, no, sorry, no one was punished for the violence which resulted in 64 deaths in 2008, which was one of the main moments of extreme violence, some of you will remember, the other one being in 2015. Now, while in the domain of what I call civil society, state rule has operated broadly on the basis of the right to rights in Hannah Arendt's sense, in many urban areas of South Africa, it is state rule in an uncivil society. This rule is not founded on the right to rights. Rather, the state rule is often based on relations of patronage, frequently accompanied by violence. So unlike in the domain of civil society, where access to courts to resolve differences and contradictions is commonplace, in what I call uncivil society, it is violence, often but not exclusively state violence, that is frequently deployed as a first resort to resolve differences and conflicts. The deployment of violence is often considered legitimate, and the human rights of ethnic, gender, or sexual minorities are frequently seen as threats to the established order. Finally, it is important to note that indigeneity, or perhaps rather autochthony, is frequently invoked with reference to ethnic belonging, a fact that fuels xenophobia through a constant insistence on identity and its attendant politics of particularism and exclusion. Of course, identity politics are state politics, not sociologically speaking, i.e. not by virtue of the agents who are practicing that politics, but by virtue of the fact that state politics can only think human differences and identities and not human universality. What is interesting to note is that not only does a popular politics opposed to xenophobic violence can exist, but also that when it does, it tends to exhibit a humanistic content which may form the basis of an alternative Pan-African universalism. So now I'm going to end with three brief examples of resistance to xenophobia among poor people. The first is in a township called Hutsong in 2008, a poor township on the edge of Johannesburg. They were opposed to the vicious xenophobic attacks of 2008. According to empirical studies, this was fundamentally because there had already been a political organization that had united the community against ethnic divisions. Systematically downplaying ethnic divisions, what was called the Merafong Demarcation Forum was concerned principally with the municipal demarcation, organizing around the need to incorporate the area into the province of Gauteng, proving and uniting the community around this particular struggle. In doing so, it emphasized unity in relation to the authorities and provided an ideology that united people around a sense of common purpose. Despite the fact that there had been evidence of xenophobic discrimination in the past, foreign residents in Hutsong, mainly Mozambicans but also some Somali traders, did not experience any xenophobic violence. By all accounts, leaders were able to ensure that unity of the community was maintained, a fact that was made possible due to the high level of organization and the need for political unity on the question of demarcation of boundaries and opposition to the government. The second example was in fact in Grahamstown, where I was working at the university, in 2015, in other words, very recently. In 2015, major episodes of xenophobic violence erupted, starting in the Durban area, which targeted mostly poor Africans from elsewhere on the continent. And after mid-May of 2015, this violence was extended by the state itself in various ways. Now, not really reported in depth in the press, the small university town of Grahamstown in the Eastern Cape experienced a bout of xenophobic violence in October 2015. Occurring simultaneously with the much better known student unrest around the fees must fall actions. The xenophobic violence targeted small businesses owned by Pakistanis and Bangladeshis, many of whom had married South African women. Initially organized by small African businessmen and perpetrated by taxi drivers and others, the violence led to the looting and burning of 300 shops and the displacement of several hundred people. The only organization to oppose this violence was the Unemployed People's Movement, which had been organizing in the local townships for a number of years, given the extremely high rate of unemployment in the area, by all accounts, around 70%. Now, during the xenophobic looting, members of the UPM protected shops under attack in the first hours of the crisis, gave support to people who had been burnt out, and so on. So in sum, the UPM upheld the idea that community belonged to those who live in it and contribute to it, irrespective of where they were born. Membership was not founded for them of the community, was not founded for them on indigeneity, but on contribution to the benefit of all. And recent evidence suggests that although many members of the UPM disliked foreigners, they saw the attacks on them as unjustified. In other words, personal attitudes were subordinated to an idea of what was fair or unfair. Finally, I just want to mention the case of the shack dwellers movement in Durban, Abat Lalibas and John Dolo, who have been organizing systematically against xenophobia from 2008 to the present. They organize in multi-ethnic communities. They distinguished themselves in 2008 by affirming the idea that an action can be illegal, but that no person can be illegal. So it's crazy to talk about illegal foreigners in there. They insisted that a person is a person wherever they may come from. This is their slogan. Their statement issued in 2008 is worth citing very briefly. Quote, there is only one human race. Our struggle and every real struggle is to put the human being at the center of society, starting with the worst off. An action can be illegal, a person cannot be illegal. A person is a person wherever they may find themselves. So apparent foreigners then should not be treated differently from anyone else, according to them, as people have been living side by side for years and face the same problems. Only in this way can a nation of human beings be conceived. In this manner, Abakhlalia contributed to rethinking and providing new political content to both democracy and nation in South Africa. Their statements reaffirm the universality of humanity in the contemporary context and attempt to build a political practice on this principle. In fact, during the major outbreaks of xenophobic violence in 2008 and 2015, the areas where Abakhlali had political influence did not experience xenophobic violence at all. And recently, they have been organizing events in conjunction with organizations of Congolese refugees and Somali immigrants. Just to therefore conclude, it seems most of the literature engages on what a disaster xenophobia is. Very, 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 very few texts engage on resistance to it. And it's important to listen to what people are saying among poor people in what are called townships in South Africa, precisely because there is evidence in several instances of there being political organization. And that political organization is one which, as I have tried to point out, is one which frequently points to some idea of universal humanity, which is different from the Western liberal conception of man with a capital N. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. And the third speaker is Professor Natalie BYFIELD, who is presently the Associate Professor in the Department of Sociology and Anthropology at St. John's University. She describes herself as follows: a cultural sociologist whose scholarship is interdisciplinary. She taught in the fields of sociology and media studies, and her research is broadly concerned with hegemony, specifically the construction and reproduction of inequalities in the modern Western world and the social justice response to them. Her work centers on subjugation of blackness and resistance that counters this subjugation. She is the author of the book titled Savage Portrayals, Race, Media, and the Central Park Fogger Story. Professor Natalie BYFIELD.
Uh, Good afternoon. It's quite an honor for me to be here, and I'd like to thank the organizers for including me in the panel. Looking for the clicker. Okay. My talk today really centers on what I feel the sociologists across the globe need to consider more deeply as they move ahead with theorizing and development of empirical work. And it in part centers on the new type of economy, capitalist economy that we're living in, and how it's, because of the technologies, transforming everything that we're doing related to knowledge and knowledge production. So every feature of our existence today has been rendered into digital data. For each of us participating in and or carrying out our lives on the digital platform of the socio-economic and political arenas of all modern states, a data doppelganger or a data double of our physical selves exists on databases that are maintained by state agencies like tax collection services or transit authorities that use, you know, the metro passes with the magnetic strips that track our movements. And one can also expect that if they've been in trouble with the law, or if you've done something that may attract the attention of law enforcement agencies, the criminal justice system will or may also maintain a data doppelganger of you. The existence of our digital doubles does not end there. Our doubles in the digital world exist in databases of public-private partnerships, as well as in databases of private entities such as the cell phone companies like Verizon in the US or TELUS here in Canada, and social media companies like Facebook and Twitter. So the ascendance of data or information in our world that led the modern Western states to develop information capitalism occurred because of the technological advancements that created this digital platform. The major Western states that are also the racial states, and I'm thinking in terms of and using definitions by David Theo Goldberg, let's say, in defining racial states, that rose to prominence as colonial states under another system of capitalism called mercantilism. The digital platform represents a revolution in communication technologies because it eliminated the time delay in communication and allowed for the merging or convergence of various modes of communication, such as still images, moving text, moving images, text, audio, and they put this all on one platform. So these technological developments allowed for the rise of information capitalism and allowed information to become one of the most important commodities in private and public sectors. And this platform underpinning the digital doubles of ourselves just described above is used and in many instances can and will be controlled by the state. As these technological developments in our information society have been underway, there's been another set of conversions taking place. So for the last 50 plus years, a transformation in the institutions that by design are supposed to foster social control either through socialization and or forced conformity, has a conversion in those institutions has taken place in the US, in the UK, as well as other major Western societies. And many of the changes in the US institutions that force conformity occurred through the passage of major crime-fighting legislations in consecutive so-called liberal and or so-called conservative administrations beginning in the mid-1960s and continuing through the Obama administration. And they created legislations with titles like War on Crime, War on Drugs. However, some scholars have viewed these developments as a backlash against the increasing racial democratization taking place in the US in the form of the civil rights movement. Because of course, the establishment that created these developments justified them through moral panics around drugs, gangs, and guns. So the new laws institutionalize a new attitude about crime, criminality, and criminalization under a political agenda that's typically referred to as law and order. And this law and order agenda began in the 1940s, and we still hear the new person in the White House 45. that's as far as I'll go. Using that label. So under the law and order agenda, the federal government accomplished a number of very significant changes in the criminal justice system. It financed the great expansion of the federal prison system, instituted mandatory minimum prison sentences, increased the length of prison sentences for certain infractions, added a plethora of new laws, drastically expanded and or created new federal bureaucratic regimes to help local communities address their perceived crime problems. So these are administrative units that oftentimes operated with nonprofits. but what these bureaucratic units ultimately did, and they were financed greatly in the hundreds of millions of dollars, was increase local surveillance from the federal level into local communities. And they also enhanced the support, the financial support of local communities, the federal government. So this is in part what people refer to as a carceral state that has been constructed while simultaneously we had this new information capitalism developing in the society. The judicial part of the government in the US also played a role in the building of the carceral state and ruled on cases that provided more and expanded the support, the powers of local police. So my talk is concerned with the contemporaneous changes in the technologies undergirding Western liberal democracies and the application of those technologies to the new culture of control that has emerged in these societies. And I am particularly interested in what will happen when we center racism and racialization in the analysis of these developments. Because what we have seen is that, much of the analysis, with the exception of the carceral state scholars, much of the analysis doesn't always center racism in the work that's being done to understand how these developments are changing lives for people. So my hope for this work is that by centering racism and racialization in the analysis, new nuanced understandings of the evolution of racial states will emerge that can contribute to studies of how racism and racialization operate within the fusion of information capitalism, the carceral state, and surveillance, particularly in light of the fact that these developments are taking place in the racial states that emerge with the rise of mercantile capitalism and colonialism. So the emergence of the carceral state atop the foundation of information capitalism should encourage scholars and or those concerned with social justice to assess surveillance practices for the following. The collection and management, this is our doppelganger, by the way, because all of us, there's a double of us in the system that's digitized. You can see from this chart too, and this is fairly recent, 2018, just still the rates of incarceration in the US. But what I'm primarily concerned with is talking about how the collection, management, and mining of data by policing agencies for social control, specifically racialized social control, is affecting our lives. The ease with which police are able to bring together data from disparate and discrete sources are operating in the world today, and the significance of those changes in this latest era of policing that engages strategies of predictive policing. And I'm also concerned with the scientific methodologies and processes underlining those developments and their use in the continued development of policing as a form of racism. So, I want us to take a look at how this is operated in New York. In New York City, this is operated through practice of stop and frisk, and it's called stop and search in other countries, in other Western countries. And what we have seen, particularly over the periods between the 1990s and the 2013, is this intense increase in the use of stop and frisk. And the only reason that we have a fall off in 2013 is because of a successful court case that ruled the practice unconstitutional. But when we see this, when we see these types of practices, I just want to itemize certain things that you should keep in mind. That means that during this period of stop and frisk in New York City, the city stopped, police in the city stopped at least 5 million, made at least 5 million stops. Of those stops that were made, we know that they occurred for reasons of racism and reasons of racialization. But of those stops, blacks made up 25% of the population, represented about 54% of the people stopped. Latinos, who made up about 23% of the population, were 32% of the people stopped. Whites, who made up 43% of the population, were about 10% of the people stopped. 89% of the black and Latino men stopped were innocent. There was no activity they were engaged in that could be construed as illegal. And during the entire 11 years, because remember, gun was one of the moral panics, during the entire 11 years of this stop and frisk practice under the Bloomberg administration, which is whose data you're seeing here, the gun recovery rate was 1/6 of 1%. So this gives you a sense of the racial disparity in rates of stop versus innocence. And we ask ourselves, why is this happening then? And we know that racism is one of the reasons that this is happening. We know racialization is one of the reasons this is happening. But the other reasons that we have to pay attention why this is happening is because of the type of data that can be collected. These are the forms that they collect the data on. And you are given, you are required to give an extraordinary amount of detailed data about your lives. So this is the data that's now being used and reproduced through the information, the structures of the information capitalism. And these data are being reproduced, and literally data doubles of the people who have been stopped now exist in the system and are shaping the ways in which, based on the classifications that they use to analyze the data, are shaping the ways in which they define the people, define race, and identify how we will operate and the levels of freedom that people will have to operate in this society today. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Bielefeld. And finally, Professor Francis Henry is a retired professor from York University in Toronto, whose formal training was in anthropology. She's one of the Canada's leading experts in the study of race, racism, and anti-racism, which she says led her into an area of interdisciplinary research. Since the mid-70s, when she published the first study of attitude towards people of color, she has consistently pioneered research in this field. Her books include co-authoring the fourth edition of The Color of Democracy, Racism in Canadian Society, with her most recent offering being The Equity Myth, which focuses on race, racism, and discrimination in university. Her other interest is in Caribbean studies. Professor Henry.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is the moment you've been waiting for. We finally get to Canada. So I was asked to present on multiculturalism 50 years later. Canada is well known for providing the world with a model of governments that emphasizes inclusivity and the integration of migrants. Now nearly 50 years old, multiculturalism has become a mainstay of Canadian government, and as a model, it has served as a template for many other countries. It is now more than time to reevaluate its effectiveness in achieving its goal of a multicultural society on its national identity, its foundation values, institutional organization, and intergroup relations. Does multiculturalism exist in name only, or has it made a beneficial and positive impact on Canadian life, society, and culture? From its very beginnings in 1971 through several stages to its legislative status in the Multiculturalism Act of 1988, it has had its supporters and detractors. Some saw it as providing the assurance of true inclusivity and a multi rather than a bi-cultural country. Others, particularly critics and detractors, understood it to mean divisiveness and ghettoization, and its strongest critics denounced it as a whitewash of Canada's racist past and the systemic institutional biases which creates a false impression of inclusion. Today, the relevance of multiculturalism has fallen off the public agenda, and it is glibly accepted that Canada is a multicultural society and state. Its multiculturalism is taken for granted, and the most recent census demonstrates why. Of its 35 million inhabitants, 22.3 are so-called visible minorities, while 4.9% are Aboriginal or Indigenous. In its largest city, here in Toronto, more than half, 51.5%, are visible minorities, and 20% speak a non-official language. So if multiculturalism is no longer a really contested reality, have these years of acceptance brought any real changes or improvements to the lives of the people it was supposed to improve and protect? My aim in this presentation is to briefly survey changes in the attitudes and structural organizations of Canadian society over these last 50 years. Has racism, especially against the so-called visible minorities, disappeared, been diminished? Has access and equity become the hallmarks of their experience in this country? I will conclude this, I hope, brief presentation by suggesting that multiculturalism, as it has been defined, has outlived its usefulness, and what is now needed is a new but realistic approach to a heterogeneous society. I'd like to begin with some thoughts about the language of multiculturalism. Frequent terms that are used in this sense include equity, equality, diversity, and inclusion. All of these are generally understood to provide anti-discrimination solutions. Diversity and inclusion, however, are very different, since inclusion obviously means being part of. Diversity, however, simply refers to being different without specifying anything further. So one of the main problems facing multiculturalism here and elsewhere is that the term diversity does not lead anywhere. And in analyzing the effects of multicultural policies and legislation on our society, we are really asking whether it has led to inclusion. Diversity has become the language of multiculturalism, and it has become a buzzword for the policies of organizations, institutions, government agencies, etc., who believe that becoming diverse will have the same effect as being included or becoming truly multiculturalism. Becoming diverse simply means that there is more of an effort to hire people who are deemed to be different. Diversity remains an appealing concept for institutions to use and to signal that they are against racism and are in compliance with the prevailing multiculturalism. But there is too much evidence to support the contention that it does not lead to either inclusion or equality. What is the evidence? Examination of two of the most hallowed institutions of Canadian society, whose very basis supports equality and inclusion, that is the academy, the university, and the legal profession and the justice system on which it is built, have both been exposed as not practicing what they supposedly preach. In my most recent co-authored publication, The Equity Myth, seven of the most established critical race theorists in the country revealed the inadequacies of academic institutions, despite many efforts, which for the most part amount to no more than a well-worded mission statement and some minor cosmetic changes. Inequality, indifference, and reliance on outmoded conservative academic traditions characterize the modern neoliberal university. And this is the main theme that pervades the conclusions of our research, based on a nationwide four-year study. Whether one examines representation in terms of numbers of racialized and indigenous faculty members, their positioning within society, their earned income as compared to white faculty, their daily life experiences within the university as a workplace, etc., the results are the same. Racialized and indigenous faculty and disciplines or areas of their expertise are, on the whole, low in numbers and even lower in terms of power, prestige, and influence within the university. A recent controversy in the legal profession of Ontario provided another example of how a deep rift between establishment libertarians who wish to reject a simple proposal. In September, the Law Society sent an email asking all lawyers, nearly 60,000 lawyers and paralegals, reminding them of the requirement to come up with a statement, mind you, not an action, that, quote, acknowledges their obligation to promote equality, diversity, and inclusion, and towards their colleagues, employees, clients, and the public. There was a huge pushback from members, most of them white men, because this statement supposedly violated freedom of expression. Luckily, despite its opposition, that simple request passed. What is noteworthy in these two institutional examples is that racism, discrimination, the quest for equality and inclusion remain as contested areas of behavior, even in some of the most prestigious arenas of Canadian society. And one of the main criticisms of multiculturalism from its inception is that it provides a cultural solution rather than attacking the structures of society and ameliorating discrimination against people. Groups most frequently cited in the earlier discourses and even today are people of African origin or blacks and indigenous people. And in looking at the evidence, we see now that these two groups who have always stood out as continuing victims of negativity and exclusion are now joined by a third group. Islamophobia is today considered the greatest threat, and there have been several cases where anti-Muslim sentiment has led to violence, the destruction of property, and aggression towards, microaggressions towards people. So despite the fact that the government has attempted to analyze why such Islamophobia exists. They've made no real attempt to control it. With respect to the black population, recent studies of the black experience note that despite some real contributions to growth and success, inequalities continue. And of particular concern are the inequalities and the indifferent treatments of black students in our school system. And finally, of course, the continued very strained relationship between the black community, communities, and the police have achieved an enormous amount of attention. Continuing as well has been the way in which Canada's Indigenous communities are still in a state of poverty with very low levels of education, limited employment opportunities, inadequate housing, poor health, etc., despite the so-called concern of the government of the country. One of the main problems, I think, in describing and trying to analyze and hopefully control racism against these groups is the use of aggregate data. And as sociologists, we know how damning that can be. When all these multi-ethnicities are examined under the rubric of visible minorities, we are unable to ascertain what is really happening in each individual community. But despite a lot of criticism, our government continues using this labeling and collecting data in this fashion. So where should we go now? A new model of what has been called post-multiculturalism. The world has evolved, globalization, transnational movement of people, the greater attention to international human rights, the complexity of diversity, politics, etc. Ours increasingly is a post-multicultural world of diverse complexities whose evolving realities, shifting discourse, and emergent structures are challenging how we think, talk, and engage. In a post-cultural model of governments, society is reproduced but also transformed by destigmatizing ethnicity in defining who gets what. In a post-ethnic society, accommodating to difference remains important, but it also reconstitutes society by including the many ways in which people experience reality. The fluidity of the world we live in erodes the legitimacy of the nation state through globalization and the like. Diversity management becomes increasingly fluid but also contested. And of particular note in expanding the parameters of a multicultural regime is the challenge of differently accommodating a diversity of diversities at the level of government policy, institutional adjustment, and people's lived experiences. What's proposed instead of a tired and dated multiculturalism is a post-multiculturalism mindset and governance model more attuned to the realities of an emergent post-multicultural world. It provides an interpretive lens, a discursive shift, and a governance model that points in the right direction. It provides a conceptual starting point for rethinking the basis of living together within and through diverse complexities, of differently accommodating a multi-leveled world of minorities within minorities, and of embracing the challenge of engaging diversities across an increasingly post-national terrain. Maintaining Canada's traditional values of multiculturalism, which are tolerance, inclusion, and equality, but recognizing and committing to a more realistic post-multiculturalism would again provide a template for other societies to follow. Thank you.
take questions. We have about 10 minutes for questions. There are microphones there. You should actually use them there. Any questions? Yes. There's another hand. Okay. Yes, noted. There. I see three hands. Yes. You can start.
Good afternoon. My name is Anne Wiltshire. I'm from Stellenbosch University in South Africa. I have a question for Francis Henry. I was wondering about this differently accommodating other people within a country. How does that differ from affirmative action? I would just like to clarify between that. And then coming from maybe with my context in South Africa, do you not run the risk of increasing the racism between some groups? How do you overcome that? To have, if you, what you're saying, to have more tolerance. If you could maybe speak a bit more about that.
Well, I think to begin with.
We'll just wait. We'll take all the questions and then just note, and then you'll respond. Yes.
Thank you. I have a question for Professor Byfield. You might run out of the time to explain how the police collected the data about the black and the Latino community, Latino men disproportionately. So could you tell us a little bit about more how and then what type of data the police collected in the New York City? Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
Hi, Robert Rushline, Real Economy Institute. Nominated the last 3 years for the Nobel Peace Prize. My work, I've noticed a strong correlation between military spending and homicides and crime and things like that. And it's even stronger than the spirit level association with income inequality. And when you break it down in the United States states, it's very strong there. It's up in the high 90s in some of my findings. And so I see militarism as a lurking background to a lot of social dysfunction and corruption and crime that happens in America. I see it as a decline of empire and a cause of the social decay internally of empire. And I wonder if any of you have noticed any of these effects, particularly a military spending effect on the situations you have studied.
Thank you. One last question. Yes.
Hi, mine's with regards to the last two speakers, specifically about using race and ethnicity in administrative data sets. And I think, Professor Byfield, you were kind of getting to that point about the idea of surveillance and blackness. And I guess, what do you see the place of those administrative data sets and the use of those identities, given identities are so dynamic and diverse? And I guess, as you're alluding, how do we deal with this in our work? If you can elaborate on that, thanks.
Thank you. Professor NEOCOSMOS, that, and then we'll end the slide.
No question for me.
Okay.
Yes. There's quite a broad range of data that's collected to answer the first question. So they'll collect data about eye color, hair color, tattoos, birthmarks, the location that the stop occurred, and then they collect data on the reasons for the stops, what they suspect you of doing, because they're allowed, the broad police powers that were expanded during the Warren Court that I alluded to with the building of the buildup of the carceral state, allow police to make stops not for probable cause, but for if they're suspicious of something you're doing. And so they also collect data on what they suspect you might be involved in. And the issue is that they use this data now, and they They try to draw, find associations between the location you were stopped and other people who were stopped at that location, because they're trying to create associations between you and or any other feature about you that they have collected and that place, as well as you and any other feature about you and other people who may frequent those places. So if you can imagine, people were stopped. The stops grew, like 2011 was the year of the highest amount of stops. And there were almost 700,000 stops, these pedestrian stops in New York City. So people are stopped multiple times. And so with each stop, they're collecting different things about you. I hope that explains it, yeah. And there was another question about the use of these administrative data sets, yes? And so with these data sets, it gives them great power because of the technologies that are available to create categories. And you know, this is where it gets into some of the work that we as sociologists do, because we too are also creating categories and classifications, because that's the foundation of our science. They're creating categories and classifications that will allow people to become legible. When I say people, I mean your data doppelganger, your data double, becomes legible to them based on the categories and classifications that they're creating. And so, and this is done with, you know, data analytics and algorithms. And so in the context of you becoming legible to them because of the categories and classifications that they are using to do searches and analysis, They're creating what they think is a rendition of who you are. And then it raises all these questions about, well, who owns that data? Is that you? Because we are way beyond now, you know, the Enlightenment ideas of what is man, who, you know, and how we need to define man. We're into a different age in technology, and those principles that maybe help to advance to some degree democratization forces in the world can't help us manage the ways in which now we are being rendered through the technologies and how these technologies, because everyone is engaged in it. I shouldn't say it that way. Many people are engaged in it. Everyone is not engaged in it. But there is enough engagement for them to have collected a lot of data on a lot of people all over the globe. And so with these administrative data sets, once they start rendering them out through analysis with classifications and categorizations, they can do more granular levels of analysis. So for example, when I looked at the data of the stops in New York City and, you know, those labels around the people who are stopped and the way they just classify and lump everybody in as black, that doesn't help us to really understand what's going on with the stops. When we look at the data at another level, which is what they're doing, we notice that there is a distinction in stops between different types of black communities. So black communities, Brooklyn, a borough in New York City that has the highest concentration of blacks, Brooklyn, black communities that are predominantly immigrant communities, and the immigrants typically are from the Caribbean and Africa, they experience extremely high rates of stops relative to whites, like communities that are predominantly native-born blacks, but they experience noticeably less amounts or fewer stops than communities that are predominantly native-born blacks. So we have to ask ourselves then, why are these distinctions happening? What about the way in which they're processing the data leads them to come up with interpretations and outcomes that say, we need to police this community in this particular way. This is how we'll deploy our resources. So this is how the technology is being used. And at the same time, because they create those distinctions, there's a racialization that will take place that will create distinctions between the black Caribbeans and the so-called native-born blacks.
Yes, I think the question had to do with whether affirmative action isn't already in place and was designed to move us beyond just bare multiculturalism. I think to a certain extent it was, but affirmative action or employment equity, as it is called in Canada, has its limitations, and it is at times rather easy to get around. And many employers and heads and decision-making situations have done that. And I understand in the United States, affirmative action has been chipped away at until it's relatively meaningless. And I'm afraid that this might be the direction that we might be going in as well. So yes, affirmative action or employment equity is a beginning step towards moving into inclusion. I think it has done a bit of good, but not nearly as much as it, you know, supposedly is cracked up to be. I wouldn't suggest that there haven't been strategies evolved for greater inclusion. There have been, but they're always curtailed, they're controlled, they're minimized. They're not at the top of the list. And one astounding example of that is if you have ever looked at the structure of a university's administration, they never in the past had vice presidents or associate presidents or whatever the terminology is used in charge of things like difference, diversity, equity, and so on. Recently, there has been a move forward. Well, that is, many universities now have a high-level decision maker in charge of equity. And very often, the person who is hired into that is a racialized person. the problem is that on the hierarchy of decision-making in an academic institution, the vice president in charge of equity usually is at the bottom of the heap. In any sort of situation like that, you have the name, you have the cosmetic image, but you don't have any real change.
So what was the about inequality?
Yes.
Have no question? Okay. It's just a question about just a point about inequality and crime in Latin America, maybe that. No, I think that I tried to make an overview about the about the Latin American sociology, about our questions, and we are now in a moment when we feel that we are in a period of change, and we finished a period with many discussions about us, about many among different colleagues about if was real drop of inequality in the region. And now we are, we entered in a different period with different political trends, and many of our findings in the last periods are put in under question. And one of the questions was if the drop in crime the increasing of crime, it continued to grow in, because we don't know how to understand the relationship between the drop of inequality and the rise in crime. So we have our theory, our works, our theory, that which associated inequality and crime. And in a period when an inequality drops a little bit, at the same time, we
underwent hikes on crime in different countries. So that for us is like a question. And maybe we need more research trying to understand two phenomena that which are not explained by concepts like exclusion or like this kind of question. So we are in a very interesting moment in Latin America because our findings, our background are put under question with new problems.
Thank you. Michael, want to last remarks?
No, I'm okay.
Okay, we have come to the end of the session, and I wish to thank all our panelists, and also want to thank you. A round of applause to all of us. Thank you.